Road tripping, plan ahead. It is important to plan ahead. It doesn't take much, a few minutes. The best thing to do is hop in your car, punch, the sun is moving here. There we go, a little better. Hop in your car and use the car's nav system to map out your drive. That's the easiest thing you can do. Just punch in the address, your destination. So I'm going to Crater Lake, Oregon, or actually Chiloquin, Oregon, Train Mountain. I put it in here, and it routes my route through all the superchargers required to get there. And hopefully more than enough to make it. And it will tell you if it knows you're not going to be making it between a couple points. So that way you can find an alternative charging method or an alternative route. Get some third-party apps. I highly recommend you have PlugShare on your phone. PlugShare tells you, and it's community-driven, it can tell you where a lot of different non-Tesla charging stations are, what kind, if other users have reported them offline or problems or quirks, or if they're pay or free stations. PlugShare, get it. Another one you should subscribe to is ChargePoint. My ChargePoint card out here. And this is stuff that you don't even, if you're still waiting for your car to be delivered, this is stuff you can do before your car is even delivered. Get yourself a ChargePoint card. It's an RFID card. You can also use your phone, but I found it, their stations work a little flaky when trying to activate from the phone, especially if it's in a poor cellular area. You just take the card, wave it across the front of the station where it says, wave here, and it goes beep. 10 seconds later, charge handle releases and you can start charging. The ChargePoint cards, sometimes they have promotions. You can get them for free. And sometimes you just got to buy them. If you do have to buy one, they're only about $5. And that includes the shipping. Come on, get in there. It's a good must have. So ChargePoint. They're the largest, as far as I'm aware, they're the largest non-Tesla network of charging stations in the world. Another one that I rarely use, but I find more of them, is Green Lots. And the Green Lots networks, I usually see those around... I only really saw them around South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia. Those are the only places I've ran into them so far. Yes, for those out there, I know they can be found other places too. That's just where I've run into them. I think that was a free card. And the accounts for both of them, you can set up an account for free. Call or email your destination. So if you're staying at a hotel, call or email your destination in advance of your trip to see if they could maybe make arrangements for you to park by a outlet. Even if it's a 120-volt outlet, 120-volt outlet is still going to give you 40 to 60 miles range overnight. And if it's a 20-amp 120-volt outlet, holy crap. Now you're like 80 or 90 miles overnight. It adds up, folks. It's slow, but it adds up. And that was the only way I made it out of Charleston in 2015, was because I was able to charge on 120 overnight at the hotel. There was like nothing around there at the time. And if it's a colder climate, worst case scenario, you're not going to gain any charge, but it'll keep your battery pack warm and keep you from losing charge overnight. You can also suggest to your destination, if they don't have anything, to join the Tesla Destination Charging Program. Tesla will provide a charging station to a business that will be willing to install it for their customers for free. Free! Strongest words in marketing. Free! I do recommend carrying an extension cord on trips. Just a small 10 or 20 foot cord is all that's needed. Sometimes all you need is, I know you really shouldn't be using extension cords, but sometimes you just need that extra few feet to reach that outlet. And if you're going to be someplace where you're going to be using a 120 volt outlet, it comes in handy. Just make sure you get a thick enough cable, a 10 or a 12 gauge cable cord, extension cord. Next, home charging, and we're almost done here. Home charging, like I said, most of your charging is going to be on a 1450 outlet for most people. If you can afford it and you have the option to, I do highly recommend the high powered wall charger. Even if you don't have the higher speed chargers in your car, the high powered wall charger, it's a permanent install, it's a cleaner install. You don't have to worry about loose plugs or unplugging or not having a UMC with you. The 1450, this will charge your car in about 6 to 9 hours from dead to 100%. Whereas a high powered wall charger, if you have the faster dual chargers in your car, can charge your car in as little as 3 hours. Now the HPWC is settable, so you can charge anywhere from 40 to 80 amps, depending on what breaker and wiring install you have. However, if you want to charge faster than what one of these little buggers can provide, you will have to either have, if you have the older Model S, the dual charger, which actually has, Tesla installs a second charger in your car, and that second charger is capable of providing a second 10 kilowatt, so you can charge up to 20 kilowatt or 80 amp. On the newer vehicles, they change things around. It used to be the standard charger's 40 amp dual charger would make it 80 amp. Now it's a single charger with two different modes, and you can pay to unlock it. It's either 48 amp for a standard charge or 72 amp. So yeah, they slowed the faster one down a bit. Why would you slow down charging? I don't know. So you're charging at either up to 12 kilowatt or 18 kilowatt on the 48 or 72 amp charger. 40 amp would be 10 kilowatt, 80 amp dual charger would be 20 kilowatt. So it depends on what year and what version of the Tesla you have. The dual chargers only applied to earlier Model S's. When Tesla did the refreshed front end, that's when they got rid of the dual chargers, and now it's either the standard or the high power charger, no dual chargers. And last, what we're going to cover in this video is superchargers. Excellent power source. The supercharger network has expanded astronomically in the last couple of years and continues to grow at an amazing pace. Don't be afraid to use them. But please, be courteous to other people. If there's a lot of people at the stalls, and you shouldn't do this at all anyways, when you're done charging, move your car. Don't leave it sitting there. Don't unplug it. Move your vehicle. Don't leave it sitting at a supercharger. Plug in, get the power you need, and move it. Don't be afraid to stay a little extra longer, though. And if you're still charging and you want to get a little extra safety margin in there, don't be afraid to take it, though. Just the worst thing you can do is just leave your car sitting there when it's not charging. On top of that, there's the idle fees that Tesla charges, 45 cents a minute, if your car is sitting there plugged in without charging. Just be courteous, move your car. The Tesla Nav is excellent for routing your trip through said supercharging network, and I highly recommend you use your Tesla Nav. It'll also tell you when you have enough power to make it to your next stop. It's gotten more accurate over the last couple of years, but I don't trust it 100%, especially when an extra 5 minutes at a supercharger, and I'm backtracking again, an extra 5 minutes at a supercharger can give you a ton extra power. Just take it. Take it. Why not? You're already there. It might save you from having to slow down and creep your way to the next stop or supercharger when you can just spend 5 more minutes getting more power. And that's all the ideas I have for this video. If you think I've missed anything in this video, this will make this part one, and I'll do a follow-up. If you have questions, comments, concerns, put them in the description box below. Please provide your questions, because that's I'd love to answer them for you or clarify things more in future videos. Don't forget, like and subscribe, and see you guys out on the road.